welcome to the final video in our series on the goal of low inflation, which is all going to be about how aggregate supply side factors cause or ease cost inflation. Cost inflation being when businesses passed on increased costs to consumers via higher prices, which then obviously degrades living standards as our purchasing power erodes. So if you have been following along, lesson one was all about the goal of low inflation and how it impacts living standards, the goal being that the average level of prices rises on average of 2-3% on average over time. The second lesson was all about calculating CPI, which is all about looking at the difference between CPI in 2 years, times that by 100 divided by the first year to get that overall level of inflation. Then in our third lesson, we looked at how recent aggregate demand side factors could cause or ease demand inflation. So now we're going with our final part, which is all about that cost inflation. So we look at it here, our key skills are cause of inflation, including cost inflation, and how aggregate supply side factors have influenced that inflation rate overall. So our key skills, the same as aggregate demand side, it really covers everything. You really bring everything together to look at relationships between factors and apply real world knowledge to it. That drives us straight into this whole diagram from recent trends in the inflation rate. Look at this in the aggregate demand side video. As you should hopefully remember, with anything, we're only looking at the last 2 years, so ignore anything before that. Recent in economics is the last 2 years now. You might get questions on a stack and things like that where you have the inflation rate if your teacher's really nice, then you might have other factors like consumer confidence, the exchange rate, business confidence, all these other things which are going to have impacts. You need to be able to draw connections between them about their relationship. We're going to be doing a little bit of other work on that in the future. There are stuff in the exam prep playlist on this channel that will tie in with that, but keep that in the back of your mind as it's really important to be able to look at that. And when you are answering questions, when there is a graph available, always use the data provided to you as there'll be marks allocated towards that. And you are kind of being foolish not to do it. And a lot of students don't, and it's just easy marks that you are giving away. So to get into what cost inflation is, so cost inflation exists when cost rises are passed on to firms as higher prices to protect their profit margins. So to put it in really simple terms, cost inflation happens in one of two ways. So either businesses have an increased cost of production, then because of that, they increase their prices to protect their profit margins, and this leads to cost inflation. And that's essentially the step-by-step of how you describe it. Alternatively, sometimes businesses will have a lower cost of production, or either through cheaper resources or increased efficiency. That will hopefully lead to lower prices or more production at the same price, and that eases cost inflation. They are really, really important when it's looking at cost inflation. But you need to know cost inflation is all about, from the business's side, increasing or changing prices to protect their profit margins because they care about their profit. So some recent supply side conditions, we're just going to smash them fairly quickly in terms of the effect they have. So oil prices as one. Recently, oil prices have been rising, which can increase the cost of production for businesses. So that could happen through either using oil as a part of their production as an input, or as part of like transportation and all those kind of things with businesses. So that's going to increase cost of production, which will lead to increased cost inflation. I don't know why that should be CI, but that's generally it for that one. Changing the exchange rate. So recently the Australian dollar has been increasing. It's now 77 US cents as of recording this on the 18th of March. That can decrease the cost of imported inputs for producers. So that's increasing from about 63 US cents at some points at the end of 2019 and early 2020. So it's increased a fair bit, which means that imported inputs are cheaper, which can lower cost inflation overall, as that's lowering the cost of production for businesses. And we always call that easing cost inflation, as there is less price pressure in that way. One thing that I haven't pointed out before that's probably really important to point out, demand inflation makes up a much bigger proportion of inflation than cost inflation. So demand inflation is going to affect the goal a lot more than cost inflation. Change in labor productivity and efficiency, or efficiency. So recently our productivity growth has been weaker on average than some earlier periods, like in the late 90s, early 2000s, we were going through a technological boom, and efficiency and productivity increases were significant. Now, not so much. And we're really looking for ways that can increase that. But if productivity is not increasing at the same rate, that's going to increase pressures and cost of production pressures, and therefore potentially lead to increased cost inflation, or at least increased pressures. Changing wage costs. So wages represent about 50 to 70% of overall production costs for firms. And recently there's been an increasing push to deregulate labor markets. So things like penalty rates have changed in areas like hospitality to pay less on public holidays and weekends. So that lowers cost of production for businesses, which should actually lead to lower prices and eased cost inflationary pressures. One of the issues we face in Australia is we have one of the highest minimum wages in the world. Unlike that statement, which says Australia has one of the highest minimum wages in Australia, which makes technically correct, but that should say in the world. Ironically, this is my third time recording this, and It's my third time recording this, and that's the first time I picked up on that. So very, very important to point that out, that if our wages are high, businesses aren't going to want to produce in Australia, or if they do produce in Australia, it will mean that cost of production is high, and therefore prices are probably going to be high because of that, and therefore that means more cost inflation. A couple more. So changes in climatic condition affecting production. So drought and bushfires have been pretty massive at limiting our access to our natural resources and then increasing the cost of inputs. So that leads to increased cost of production, which then leads to increased cost inflation. The influence of competitive and market power. So things like the Australian supermarkets in their duopoly or oligopoly gives them a lot of control over increasing prices, as you probably saw during panic buying in March of last year. Prices of things increased pretty quickly if there was scarcity in those areas, which is more from the demand inflation, but it was also harder for them to source a lot of products, and that drove prices up. It was taking longer to get things here. Shipping was becoming more expensive, so that increased cost of production can also lead to increased prices and therefore increased cost inflation. Lastly, changes in cost of materials used in production. We've kind of covered that through oil and the natural disasters there. And then changes in interest rates. So recently the cash rate is 0.1%, which is the lowest it has been in history. And that means that businesses also have lower interest rates compared to previous periods. This means that businesses who have existing business loans have lower repayments on those loans, which means cost production is lower, and that should lead to eased cost inflationary pressures. So less cost inflation overall and potentially lower prices. So that's really good. But theoretically, you could be asked about what's going to happen if interest rates increase. They're not expecting interest rates to increase for at least a few years. But if interest rates are to increase, it's going to be the opposite of that. So firms might have increased cost of expansion, and that pass that on to consumers through cost inflation. But also that have increased repayments on existing loans, and therefore they'd have to pass those costs on to consumers to protect their profit margin, which would lead to cost inflation. And that is pretty much it for these. So with all of them, it's either if it decreases productivity or increases their cost of production, it leads to them increasing their prices to protect their profit margins and leads to cost inflation. Or if it decreases their cost of production, it means that cost inflation eases as they can pass on those savings to consumers. To show this graphically, I'm going to draw it up here. We're going to have our axes with our general price levels. And then our real GDP at the bottom. Our aggregate supply curve and our aggregate demand there. And so, say for example, a natural disaster happens and that negatively impacts our resources. That's going to lead to an unfavorable shift in aggregate supply, which shifts to the left. And as you can see, prices are higher and supply is lower. So that means that businesses have passed on those increased costs to consumers through higher prices. Then if we have the opposite, if good things happen, so let's say we find more resources somehow, or new technology booms, we're going to have increased aggregate supply, new curve forms, where we have a larger amount supplied at a lower price, which is going to ease cost inflationary pressure. pressures. Just to show you one more thing, sometimes they might be drawn in slightly different ways. Sometimes I'll follow this curve because this tends to be the small, that flat part there is at a certain price, no matter what, there'll be a certain amount supplied. Sometimes you follow that curve and then just go up for an unfavorable shift, or sometimes I'll do it for the favorable one as well and just show it like that. That's just a different way that it can be graphically shown. So just be prepared. It means the same thing as what we just drew before. And that's it for this part of the topic. So next up, we'll be going into the goal of full employment. We'll start off with what it is, how it impacts living standards, how it's measured, limitations, then AD and AS factors that impact it. As always, head to the website over there, therunningeconomy.com, to look at some of the blogs about basically economics and some skills with sex, some general tips, all those kind of things. Bully your teachers into buying some of the resources like the guide to task words up there, which is incredibly useful. If you're a student and you just want to buy it for yourself because your school's not going to buy it, feel free to hit me up for some sweet, sweet discounts. If you have any questions, email me, leave a comment below, or join our Discord where there is over 60 teachers and students who are conversing about VC economics and helping each other to do as well as possible in 2021. Other than that, I hope you have a wonderful day, and I hope that PowerPoint doesn't crash when I close this time, because this is the third time and I don't know if I'm willing to do a fourth today. Other than that, have a wonderful day and I will see you next time. Bye.